Researchers report in the journal Science that they've discovered a new organelle, one that could someday lead to huge innovations in agriculture. So let's meet the nitroplast. The nitroplast fixes nitrogen. Not fixed like broken, but nitrogen by nature is chemically pretty inert, and only a handful of organisms can convert atmospheric nitrogen into ammonia that life forms can actually use for biological processes. Those handful of organisms are all bacteria and archaea. They're prokaryotes. And without nitrogen-fixing microorganisms, plant and animal life as we know it would cease to exist because we cannot fix nitrogen ourselves, and nitrogen is mission critical on the life needs things to live list. Some organisms that can't make our own nitrogen make a symbiotic deal with these nitrogen-fixing organisms. Plant families like beans and clovers have little root nodules, which give nitrogen-fixing bacteria a place to stay and a source of fixed carbon in exchange for their bioavailable nitrogen. It's energetically expensive for plants to offer that deal, but it guarantees them access to precious, precious nitrogen regardless of the soil conditions. And because it's energetically expensive, and because a handful of plants are putting bioavailable nitrogen into the soil anyway, most eukaryotes just freeload off the nitrogen fixers. It's why in agriculture you have to cycle crops. Most crops will just freeload and slurp up your soil nitrogen, so every so often you have to plant one of those nitrogen-fixing symbiotic species like legumes that has the connect with nitrogen-fixing prokaryotes to renew the soil. Meanwhile, animals get their nitrogen by eating the plants that got their nitrogen from the soil or from animals that ate the plants and so on. So the point is that eukaryotes like plants, animals, and fungi need bioavailable nitrogen, but we don't have the machinery to make it ourselves. It sure would be convenient if a eukaryote had an organelle to make nitrogen themselves, right? Well, one eukaryote can. Now, I'm gonna show you this little guy. You're not allowed to laugh, okay? This is Brarudosphera bigelowii. And yes, we know. They are not a dye, they are a marine alga. And Brarudosphera bigelowii are a very good little plankton, okay? As algae, B. bigelowii are eukaryotes, so by rights they shouldn't be able to fix their own nitrogen. Only they can, because they are the only species that has this nifty new organelle, the nitroplast. How did B. bigelowii accomplish this amazing feat? How would a eukaryote evolve a totally novel function like this? That's the neat trick. It didn't. See, sometimes prokaryotes pioneer a major innovation in the space, and eukaryotes merger and acquisition this little bacterial startup. The classic example here is with mitochondria. Do you know how we got the little powerhouse of the cell? Let me ask a different question. Ever wonder why mitochondrial DNA is a separate thing from our usual nuclear DNA? It's because the current hypothesis is that mitochondria used to be independent bacteria called alpha proteobacteria, and roughly 2.2 billion years ago, some archaea ate them. We ate them. And just to spite us, the little suckers didn't die. They were like, you know what? I got my own membranes. You're not gonna get me that easy. Actually, I like it here. I think I'm gonna stay. Turns out, we both got something out of this relationship. They got inputs they could use as energy, and they converted those inputs to outputs that we could use for energy, which let us do cool, metabolically expensive things like have a nucleus, which ultimately defines us as eukaryotes. This is endosymbiosis, a mutualistic relationship where one thing lives inside another thing, like a little matryoshka. And it's not the only time eukaryotes have pulled this stunt. 1.5 billion years ago, so roughly 700 million years after the mitochondrial shenanigans, a subset of plants, algae, and a handful of other eukaryotes did the same thing again. Only this time, they didn't form a partnership with alpha proteobacteria, but with a type of cyanobacteria. And that cyanobacteria's neat trick was, they can convert sunlight energy to ATP. Yeah, that's right. Chloroplasts were once bacteria, and algae and plants were like, nah, I'm gonna engulf you, and you work for me now. And that's the engine behind plant photosynthesis. Like mitochondria, chloroplasts have their own DNA and everything, and like mitochondria, chloroplast can't be made by the plant cell itself, so when plant cells divide, each daughter cell has to inherit their own chloroplast. Which brings us back to our D12. Sorry. Brings us back to big bigelowii. Their nitroplast is a product of endosymbiosis with bacteria, like mitochondria and chloroplast once were. And the merger and acquisition seems to have taken place about 100 million years ago in the late Cretaceous. Our researchers have sequenced the nitroplast genome, and like the chloroplast and many nitrogen-fixing bacteria, the nitroplast appears to have once been a type of cyanobacteria. It's called Candidatus atelocyanobacterium thalassa. Thalassa because it's a marine thing. Remember, it's a marine algae. Atelocyanobacterium, meaning incomplete cyanobacteria, and Candidatus because that's just a thing we call prokaryotes that we can't culture in a petri dish. And because A. thalassa rely on bigelowii algae as their symbiotic partner, we'll never be able to culture them on their own, so they'll always be a little Candidatus. They're just a baby. Actually, since we're talking about their symbiosis, that brings up a good point. If endosymbiosis is just a mutualistic relationship of one organism inside another, what's the difference between an endosymbiont and organelles like mitochondria, chloroplast, and this nitroplast? Well, there are plenty of organisms that are inside another organism without being organelles. For instance, nitrogen-fixing plants keep their little symbiotic partners inside their root nodule cells. Here, you can see microscopy of a single soybean root nodule cell. The little fried egg-looking parts are specialized symbiosomes from the plant that enclose the nitrogen-fixing bacteria. Plants and fungi, in particular, have tons of endosymbionts, and many of those endosymbionts are totally reliant on their plant host cell to live. So, how come those don't count as organelles, but big bigelowii's nitroplast does? That's what this new paper is about, proving that A. thalassa inside B. bigelowii isn't just an endosymbiont, but actually counts as an organelle. See, an endosymbiont may live inside another cell. It may be unable to live outside that cell. It may even lose some genes that it needed as an independent organism, but doesn't need now that the host is providing what was once provided by their own genes and protein synthesis. The difference is that even with that dependency, the symbiont is still in charge of some of their core functions of being a cell, like seizing the means of reproduction. With organelles like mitochondria and plastids, the host cell has control over the organelle's cell growth, cycle, and division, and the host cell contributes many of the proteins an organelle needs for its structure. Using X-ray tomography to observe B. bigelowii's cell division and tracking the coordinated division of both host cell and nitroplast, our scientists in this recent paper showed that B. bigelowii's ride-along is passed down through cellular generations. And through proteomic analysis, they showed that the nitroplast has such a streamlined genome that it, quote, lacks key proteins required for photosynthesis and making genetic material, leaving it to rely on the host cell to provide organs for proteins for these core functions. Altogether, that means the nitroplast counts as an organelle, meaning that B. bigelowii is the first nitrogen-fixing eukaryote. So what does this mean? Well, the long-term hope would be to study nitroplast biology to figure out ways to introduce this organelle to other plants, transforming them from freeloaders to nitrogen-fixing plants the way legumes are. That's no simple feat. Our unicellular algae has had 100 million years to work out this roommate relationship, building up interdependent systems to support the nitroplast, and you can't just drag and drop those into any old plant. But as complicated as that would be to figure out, and as distant from it as we are now, it's a worthy goal to explore. If we can introduce nitrogen fixation to agricultural crops, for instance, we could radically reduce our dependence on chemical fertilizers to maintain our food supply. So, to summarize, plenty of species have symbiotic relationships, even cells inside cells. And only a handful of times in the history of Earth biology have organisms taken it farther. Mitochondria and chloroplast are both two examples of bacterial endosymbionts who, each over a billion years ago, became so inextricably integrated into their host cell that eventually they became organelles for those hosts. The nitroplast in this little alga is a much more recent 100 million-year-old instance of the same symbiont-to-organelle pipeline, allowing this algae species to become the first eukaryote that can fix its own nitrogen. So next time you think you know all the organelles in a cell, remember, some exceptions may apply.